हेलो दे दो। गुड मॉर्निंग एवरीवन, दिस इज अ बायोलॉजी क्लास। वी विल कंटिन्यू विद द टॉपिक द सेल द यूनिट ऑफ लाइफ। जस्ट ट्राई लेट अस रिकैप्चुलेट व्हाट एवर द इन द प्रीवियस क्लासेस वी हैव लर्नड। वी हैव गॉन थ्रू द सेल थ्योरी, द प्रोकैरियोटिक सेल्स इज एंड द कंपोनेंट्स ऑफ द सेल्स व्हिच आर द सेल ऑर्गेनेल्स दैट आर प्रेजेंट इन द सेल। एंड यस्टरडे इन द क्लासेस वी हैव डेल्ट विद द प्लाज्मा स्ट्रक्चर ऑफ द प्लाज्मा मेम्ब्रेन। नेक्स्ट विद द सेल कंपोनेंट, द अदर सेल कंपोनेंट दैट इज द सेल वॉल। दिस सेल वॉल एस्पेशली इन द प्लांट सेल्स, द प्लांट सेल्स एक्सटर्नली आर कवर्ड बाय अ tough protective layer as an outer covering and it is called as a cell wall. Cell wall is the tough outer covering of the plant cells. While explaining even in the prokaryotic cells, I had said that the bacterial cell have a cell wall. The composition of the cell wall will differ from one organism to another organisms. But especially in the plant cell, it is very tough and rigid and provide protection to the cell. This, when you observe under the microscope, three distinct parts you can see in the cell. Just remove a peel of onion and observe under the microscope. If you observe under the microscope, three distinct parts can be easily observed. Yes? So those distinct parts, a plant cell shows three distinct parts. That is the cell wall, vacuole and the nucleus. Three distinct parts of the plant cell are the cell wall, nucleus and the vacuoles. So this cell wall is present surrounding the plasma membrane. It surrounds the plasma membrane. So it is an outer membrane, rigid supporting membrane. So depend upon the cells also where they are present. As anatomy classes, you have heard about parenchyma, colenchyma and sclerenchyma. Parenchyma are soft. Yes, so that cell wall composition is different. While in colenchyma, again the composition is different. In sclerenchyma also the composition differs. Sclerenchyma are more hard, tough when compared to parenchyma and colenchyma. The composition of the cell wall depending upon the plant cells. Yes, they may contain cellulose, hemicellulose, pectin, lignin, suberin or even cutin. Composition. Bones are made up of calcium. Same way the cell wall depending. If you take parenchyma cells, they are composed of cellulose. Colenchyma cells, cellulose, hemicellulose and pectin. The sclerenchyma fibers, that is the fibers, the thread-like structures that we get from the coconut coir, which is thread-like structures, it is hard and tough. That hard and tough of that layer or a thread-like structures is because of the components like lignin, suberin and the cutin. Yes, so here the plant cell show three distinct regions, cell wall, nucleus and the vacuole. So if you go with the structure, the cell wall is made up of three distinct parts. One is middle lamella, second is primary wall, which is thick but elastic. bridged. Cell wall has different compositions depending upon the type of cells. Compositions are cellulose, hemicellulose, pectin, lignin, suberin or Q-tip. Or the main three parts of the cell wall is the middle lamella, the primary wall. The primary wall, as the word says, primary wall. The first form wall by the cell is called as the primary wall, which is thick but elastic. Elastic in the form of flexible also. It is flexible. It have the tensile strength. It shows the property of tensility by expanding and contracting. While the secondary wall is thick and rigid. So externally, if you go in detail the structure of the cell wall. First, we will go with middle lamella. This figure will make you to understand the three distinct layers of the cell wall. Just look into the diagram. For your external information or to make you clear, the diagram is being represented, though it has not been mentioned in the textbook. Just observe the figure. This is an outline or the plant cell with the three distinct parts. Distinct plant parts. A vacuole and a nucleus. So when you expand again under the microscope, the distinct parts are cell wall. Yes, so the distinct, this is a part of a cell wall. In this cell wall, the three distinct part is, this is the middle lamella. Is the middle lamella. This middle lamella is composed of, it is made up of, it is composed of calcium and magnesium pectate. It is composed of calcium and magnesium pectate. This middle lamella, if you consider two cells, if you take two adjacent cells, if you are taking the two adjacent cells, the first formed wall during the process of cell division or where there is cell plate formation. A mother cell is dividing to form two daughter cells. So during the process of cell division, when the cell divides, there is division where a mother cell undergoes and it undergoes the division dividing into two cells. So here this wall that is being formed initially between the two daughter cell is the middle lamella. Yes. Now how this middle lamella is being formed? How is there is a formation? There are endoplasmic reticulum and the Golgi complex. So the cells, the two cells, already the mother cell have all the components. So when these components are equally distributed to the daughter cells, they are being divided and are distributed to the daughter cells. During that process, the fragments of the fragments of endoplasmic reticulum and Golgi apparatus. Fragments of endoplasmic, fragments means the remaining, the leftover part of the endoplasmic reticulum and the Golgi apparatus start accumulating at the center of the cell. Start accumulating at the center of the cell. This accumulation of fragments help in the formation of cell plate. Accumulation of cell substances, the fragments of endoplasmic reticulum and the Golgi complex apparatus, it is helping in the formation of a cell plate formation. So this cell plate formation, as it develops, it is dividing the cell into two daughter cells. So in the plant cells, we say that the daughter cells are being divided or get fragmented or they get separated by the help of cell plate formation. While in the animal cell also, the fragments of, though they don't have the cell wall, though they, in animal cell there is no cell wall, but it is by groove formation. The membrane, the plasma membrane, undergo division with the help of groove. In the animal cell also, but in animal cells there is no cell plate formation, but the division is by groove formation, which thickens or deepens and divides to form the two daughter cells. Right, we will concentrate on the plant cell now. So middle lamella is the first, is the initial wall that is being developed during the process of cell division with the help of the fragments of endoplasmic reticulum and Golgi apparatus. Composition is, it is made up of calcium and magnesium cells. This is the cell, it is the protoplasm. This protoplasm contains all the required nutrients or mineral components. So that are being specifically used during the various processes of the metabolic activities of the cell. So during this metabolic activity, that is during cell division, the fragments of the endoplasmic reticulum, the endoplasmic reticulum is present near the nucleus. The Golgi complex are also being present. So these fragments get accumulated at the center. They get accumulated at the center and forms the middle lamella. With the expansion of this structure, the middle lamella. So, if you consider this as a cell, same way there is adjacent cell next to it. There is an adjacent cell.
Allowing
or it is being developed initially during the process of cell plate formation. The expanded figure, of this part is over here. This figure, observe this figure, compare this figure. When I expand it, or if I expand it and observe under the microscope, this is the middle lamella where it is made up of component is calcium and magnesium pectin. Yes, then the first formed wall side to the middle lamella is the primary wall. The first formed wall, that is this wall that is being formed, middle lamella. The first formed wall side to the middle lamella is the primary wall. This primary wall grows by the process called as intussusception. What is the meaning of intussusception? That is growth by addition of substances from internal source. Intussusception. What is the meaning of intussusception? I repeat, that is growth by addition of internal source. We can say that there are two types of growth. Yes, or naturally if you observe there are two. Take a plant, the seed germinates and produces the radical and the plumule. The radical will grow to form the roots system and the plumule grows to form the shoot system. So here this growth where the cells are dividing internally by internal processes, by internal substances. So that type of growth is called as intussusception. Same way, the primary wall is growing inside next to the middle lamella by the process or by intussusception growth, where there is deposition of chemical substances and it grows by the addition of the internal substances or the internal source. So chemically, this, as I said earlier, it is thick and elastic. It is thick and elastic or flexible, or it is flexible. It is mainly composed of cellulose, hemicellulose, and glycoproteins. It is composed of cellulose, hemicellulose, and the glycoproteins. So, the middle lamella, during the process of formation of a cell wall, the middle lamella is formed first. Then the next wall, that is the first formed wall, side to the middle lamella is the primary wall. That growth of any of the substances. So, especially here, the primary wall grows by addition of internal sources. So this process of growth is called as intussusception, and mainly it is composed of the components cellulose, hemicellulose, and the glycoprotein. Simultaneously, there is a growth or there is a development of secondary wall. Side to the primary wall, there is a growth of secondary wall. This secondary wall. Here, the growth of secondary wall is due to assertion. It is by assertion, that is from external source. It is by external source. Here, in order to give a clear explanation of what is assertion, yes, take the example of the glaciers. The glaciers, how they are being developed by the absorption of water molecules, yes, or if you take that how the rocks are being formed, the growth is not from internal source. In such examples, the growth of the Himalayas, the growth of the mountains, the growth of the glaciers, or the growth of the valleys, they are also growing, but they are non-living components. They don't have the cells. The growth is not from the internal source, but it is from the external source. So here also, the secondary wall, when some of the chemical components start depositing side to the primary wall, they start accumulating side to the primary wall and form a hard ridge like structures. That hard ridge like structure, that growth by the external source, as I said, example of the mountains, how mountains have been formed by the addition of the soil components like sulfates, phosphates, or other chemical components, they get deposited together and give the shape of a mountain. Or the glaciers, or the Himalayas you take. Yes, in the Himalayas also grow. That growth is by absorption of moisture from the external process. Here also, from external source, the secondary wall is being developed, and that growth of the secondary wall by external source, it grows by the process of external source and is known as assertion. It is thick but rigid. It is thick and rigid, usually covering of the fruits. Usually they are present as a covering of the fruits. Keep a banana or any fruits or food substances on the table for few days, so that will get dissolved because of the mobilization of the chemicals that have been present in the cell wall. Yes, so can you, here the secondary wall is slightly thick and rigid, that is tough when compared to the primary wall, where it is made up of lignin and suberin. These are the chemical components. It is composed of the chemical components, that is the lignin and the suberin. Lignin, it makes the wall very much tough. It is making the wall very much tough. So during this growth, when they are just developing, it does not completely grows, but leaves a small gap. At certain places, you cannot see the deposition of the chemicals like lignin and suberin. There is a minute space in the wall. That minute space in the wall is known as plasmodesmata. It is known as the plasmodesmata. So, during the formation of the cell wall, there is a minute gap developed between the two adjacent cells. So, this minute gap between the two adjacent cells is known as the plasmodesmata. The importance of plasmodesmata is it is helping in movement of the substances from one cell to another cell. Let it be water or especially water. So convection of water occurs through the plasmodesmata. Or we can say that the plasmodesmata is like a ventilator or a ventilation window or a window between the two adjacent cells. So here the cell wall, we'll repeat it once again with the cell wall. The cell wall shows three main components: middle lamella, the primary wall, and the secondary wall. Middle lamella, it is composed of calcium and magnesium pectate. The three distinct parts of the cell wall are middle lamella, primary wall, and the secondary wall. Middle lamella is composed of calcium and magnesium pectate. During the process of cell division, the first formed wall is the primary wall, where the fragments of endoplasmic reticulum and endoplasmic Golgi apparatus, they start accumulating between the two adjacent cells and forms a cell wall. In that, the first one is the middle lamella. This middle lamella acts as a cementing membrane between the two adjacent cells. Then the first formed wall is the primary wall, where the growth is said to be of intussusception, where it is composed of cellulose, hemicellulose and the glycoproteins. Then the secondary wall, it is growth. The growth of secondary wall is by assertion, by the addition of substances from external source like lignin and the suberin. So this, during that, it does not develop the lignin or suberin throughout the cell wall. There is a minute space for the exchange of materials between the two. So this gap is known as the plasmodesmata. So look to the figure once again. You will understand what are the parts of the cell. Next, we will go with the functions of the cell. What are the functions of the cell? Functions of the cell. It helps to maintain shape. Cell wall helps to maintain the shape of the cells, shape and size. Yes, it may help to maintain the shape and size of the cell or to the cell membrane. Yes, and it is a protective layer providing mechanical support. It is a protective layer around the plasma membrane, and also provide mechanical support. It is involved in cell-to-cell interaction. It is involved in cell-to-cell interaction, or it is responding, it is helping. So as the wall, it is interacting with the two adjacent cells. So it is involved in cell-to-cell interaction, with where it can be exchange of substances or water or even the response to stimulus from one cell to the another cell. Then it is involved in cell-to-cell interaction and also acts as a barrier for undesirable substances. Undesirable barrier. It will act, it will stop, or it is as a barrier. It is a barrier which is not allowing any of the most of the substances. Already in the previous I said that plasma membrane are selective. In plant cells, it is selectively permeable. Hope you have understood the meaning of permeability and impermeability. But in the plant cells, the cell wall acts as a barrier. It will stop the movement of undesirable substances. Undesirable substances, even it can include even the microorganisms. To the utmost or to the uttermost, the cell wall also have certain chemical substances which will not allow the entry of the microorganism. So the cell wall acts as a barrier for undesirable substances. So once again we'll go with the functions. What are the functions of the cell wall? It is maintaining the shape and size of the cell. It is as a protective and a supporting and provide mechanical support to the cell and the plasma membrane. It is involved in cell-to-cell interaction and the barrier for undesirable substances. So this is about the cell. With the next component is the endomembrane system. For this, to understand what is endomembrane system, just we will recollect the prokaryotic cells. The prokaryotic cells does not have membrane bounded organelles. It does not have the membrane bounded organelles. Those membrane bounded organelles are absent in the prokaryotic cells, but most of the eukaryotic cells, that it is composed of a system where there are double membrane organelles. It is composed of double membrane organelles. Those are endoplasmic reticulum Golgi apparatus lysosomes and vacuoles. Double membrane organelles. Even mitochondria and chloroplast. Mitochondria, you are familiar with the figure, you have learned in your previous classes in the school section. There are two membranes. So those organelles which are having outer and inner membrane, or which are having two membranes, yes, so double membrane, such organelles with two membranes are called as double membrane organelles, which includes mitochondria and chloroplast. Along with that, but these four, endoplasmic reticulum, Golgi apparatus, lysosomes and vacuoles, they are being included in the one system, that is endomembrane system. Why only one system? Because if you go with the structures are interrelated with each other. When we go in detail, we'll come to know that what are the components of the endoplasmic reticulum Golgi complex. Here, the structures of these four membranes, the double membrane organelles, are interlinked with each other. Not only the structures, even the functions are also interlinked with each other. So they work together and form a system with similar structure and the functions, which are show synchronization in their activities or in the metabolic processes, or in the, or we can say that they work together or with similar structures and the functions. So where the structures and the functions are interrelated, so they come under the same group, that group, or it is called as endomembrane system. Endo means external, membrane is the layer. So these four are included, but mitochondria and chloroplast, they are independent units. They don't come under this. If you go this with this endoplasmic reticulum and Golgi, similar structures like cisternae, tubules and the vesicles. The vesicles later on, if they develop the substances or they get modified to form lysosomes, the vesicles produced by endoplasmic reticulum and the Golgi complex get modified by the process during the metabolic activities and these are independent units. The structures are not familiar with the endomembrane system. So this endoplasmic reticulum. We'll go with the first component, that is endoplasmic reticulum. Eukaryotic cells are well-developed cells. So in the endomembrane system, we'll go with endoplasmic reticulum. They are present in all the eukaryotic cells, but except in the red blood cells, where the red blood cells does not have even the nucleus in it. Yes, they are present in almost all the eukaryotic cells, but absent in red blood cells. Or we can say that they are absent in the embryonic cells. It was first discovered by the teamwork of the scientist K.R. Porter, Claude, and with the teamwork of the scientist K.R. Porter, Claude, and Fulmer around 1953 discovered or the endoplasmic reticulum, but the term was coined by K.R. Porter. So this endoplasmic reticulum, you can look into the textbook with the plant cell. This is the nucleus, the vacuum. So we'll give importance to the endoplasmic reticulum over here. The endoplasmic reticulum usually are surrounded nucleus, endoplasmic. The nucleus are surrounded by sac-like structures called as the endoplasmic reticulum. The expansion, this when expanded, the nucleus, nucleolus, the chromatin fibers, these are the nuclear pores. Nuclear pores, the expanded figure of the endoplasmic reticulum. The teamwork of the scientist K.R. Porter, Claude, and Fulmer discovered the endoplasmic reticulum. But the term endoplasmic reticulum was coined by K.R. Porter. More number of endoplasmic reticulum you can find in the cells which are metabolically active. For example, in the liver. active cells. Which are more active cells? In the more active cells, you can find the endoplasmic reticulum, example in the liver cells. In the muscle cells, if they are present in the muscle cells, they are known as sarcoplasmic reticulum. They are known as sarcoplasmic reticulum. Here, metabolic, they are usually present in metabolically active cells, example the liver cells. In the muscle cells, they are known as sarcoplasmic reticulum. Here, the endoplasmic region again shows three distinct parts. One is cisternae, tubules, and the vesicles. So the three distinct parts of the endoplasmic reticulum are cisternae, tubules, and the vesicles. So what are these cisternae? The cisternae are the sac-like structures which are parallelly arranged one above the other. They are parallelly arranged one above the other. So these are the cisternae surrounding the nucleus, which are arranged parallelly one above the other. These are known as cisternae. The number of cisternae varies from cell to cell depending upon the activity. Usually they are involved in the synthesis of substances. If you take the example of synthesis of proteins, when the cell is in the formation of proteins or in the synthesis of proteins, you can see that there are more cisternae. So depending upon the metabolic activities, the number of the cisternae, usually there are 10 to 12 cisternae. Maximumly there are 10 to 12 cisternae. So here the cisternae are arranged parallelly on one above the other. They are the sac-like structures which are arranged parallel to each other, one above the other. And the fluid material or the area that is surrounding the cisternae is known as cytosol. It is known as cytosol. The membrane, the fluid material that is surrounding the cisternae is known as the cytosol. Internally, there is a space. There is a space. Internally, the cisternae have the space which is called as internal cisternal space. The space that is present in the sac. This is a cisternae. This is cisternae. So the space that is being present is called as internal cisternal space. This internal cisternal space contains certain enzymes which help in the process of the synthesis of certain substances inside the cell. And the cisternae are interconnected by a short tube-like structures. You can see over here, there are short tube-like structures which are connecting the two. These are known as the tubules. Between the two cisternae, there is a connection. There is a connection that is connecting the two cisternae. So these are known as the tubules. The tubules. Cisternae, there are sac-like structures surrounding the nucleus, which are parallelly arranged side by side or overlapping with each other, and they are interconnected with each other by a short tube-like structure known as the tubules. That you around the cytosol or in the cytosol or surrounding the cistae, you can find spherical structures, spherical or oval structures. These spherical structures are called as vesicles. Third component is the vesicles. So the cisternae with the deposition, with the help of the enzymes or anything, they pinch off. So when there is a process of synthesis or anything, the membrane get pinched off. When they pinched off, they are being released to form the vesicles. They are released from the vesicles. So you can find around the cisternae, there are some spherical structures surrounding the cisternae. Those are called as vesicles. The vesicles in future can be modified to form lysosomes or the vacuoles, or they form the vacuoles. The vesicles, cisternae, then the tubules and the vesicles. The vesicles are not an integral part. They are not completely deviated. They are not forming separately, as or they are not connected to the endomere, the complex or the system, the cisternae. They are slightly though they are present near, but apart of the endoplasmic reticulum, they are not completely separate, nor they are attached to the endomere, to the cisternae. Then already you might have heard about the two types of endoplasmic reticulum. There are two types of endoplasmic reticulum known as rough endoplasmic reticulum and smooth endoplasmic reticulum. Now, one more thing I like to say is that this cisternal space which is present, it is connected to the nuclear space. It is connected to the nuclear space. This is the nucleus with the nucleoplasm. So the cisternal place are interconnected to the nuclear place, or we can say that there can be exchange of substances from the nucleus to endoplasmic reticulum with the help of the nuclear space through this internal cisternal space. Now, why they are called as rough and smooth endoplasmic reticulum? Usually, the ribosomes are being synthesized by the nucleolus of the nucleus. So, when the ribosomes are being produced, they are being exited, they are being released by the nucleus. Some of the ribosomes accumulate around the nucleus. Simultaneously, the ribosomes are get attached to the membrane, to the cisternae of the endoplasmic reticulum. So these ribosomes, if the membrane of endoplasmic reticulum is associated with the ribosomes, then it is called as rough endoplasmic reticulum. If the membrane is associated, or if they contain the ribosomes, they are known as rough endoplasmic reticulum. In case if the membrane does not have the ribosomes, it is not associated with the ribosomes, then it is called as smooth endoplasmic reticulum. So what are rough endoplasmic reticulum? If the surface, if the membrane is associated with the ribosomes, we call it as rough endoplasmic reticulum. In case if the membrane is not associated with the ribosomes, it is called as a smooth endoplasmic reticulum. So the endoplasmic reticulum shows three components: cisternae, tubules, and and the vesicles. So look to the diagram once again. What are that? The cisternas are placed, or sac-like structures which are placed parallel to each other, one above the other, parallelly with each other, with the sac-like structures. Yes. So this outer lip. Internally there is a space. That space is known as internal cisternal space, where it has required enzymes. And this internal space is connected to the nuclear space of the nucleus. And the cisternas are interconnected by a short tube-like structures called as the tubules. The third, the spherical structures that are surrounding the cisternas, or that are present around the endoplasmic reticulum, are the vesicles. They are not an integral part, nor they are the separate part. So, depending upon the presence and absence, they are reclassified as rough and smooth. For your external information, let me go with the differences between the rough endoplasmic reticulum and the smooth endoplasmic. How you are going to differentiate the differences between rough, in short, rough endoplasmic reticulum and smooth endoplasmic reticulum? This reticulum, as I said, they are associated with the ribosomes. Smooth, they are not associated with the ribosomes. They are also known as granular structures. Smooth are known as agranular. Granular means what? Granules. That is the ribosomes, granules. As they are, the membrane is associated with the ribosomes, they are called as granular structures. It is not associated with the ribosome granules, so they are called as agranular structures. This is a rough membrane. It's a rough membrane associated with ribosomes. The membrane is said to be rough because it is associated with the ribosomes. This membrane is smooth as it is not associated with the ribosomes. It is not associated with the ribosomes. Here, the rough endoplasmic reticulum, if you go with the figure of the plant cell, the nucleus, the endoplasmic reticulum, especially when it is undergoing the process of protein synthesis, they are more actively metabolically active. So you can find more number of cisternae and less number of tubules and vesicles. If they are associated with the ribosomes, the endoplasmic reticulum has more number of cisternae, well, less number of tubules and the vesicles, while the smooth have few number of cisternae but more number of tubules and the. Usually they are present near the nucleus. The rough endoplasmic reticulum, they are usually present near the nucleus. These are slightly away. slightly away from the nucleus. And the most important functions of the rough and the smooth. So, in rough, they have more number of cisternae with less tubules and vesicles. They are nearer to the nucleus. It is mainly involved, if rough endoplasmic reticulum is mainly involved in the protein synthesis. Ribosomes are the protoplasmic unit, ribonucleoprotein particles. These ribosomes in this cell help in the synthesis of proteins. So ribosomes, when associated with endoplasmic, are involved in the synthesis of proteins. While the smooth endoplasmic reticulum, they are involved in the synthesis of steroids, hormones, vitamins, even carbohydrates and the fats. So try to be familiar with the functions. The rough endoplasmic reticulum are mainly involved in the synthesis of the proteins, while the smooth, they are involved in the synthesis of steroids and the hormones. So in today's class, we have studied about the two components, that is the cell wall and the endoplasmic reticulum. Still, there are three components that come under the endoplasmic reticulum, that is the Golgi apparatus, the lysosomes and the vacuoles. So in the next class, we will continue with the endomembrane system. So here in this class, we have gone through the cell wall and the endoplasmic reticulum. For any external information, you can just go through it. So some external informations are also being given apart from the NCERT textbook to make you clear about the concept. Sometimes unexpected questions are also being asked. So next class, we will deal with the other endomembrane system.